Thanks, Shannon. Thanks for inviting me to talk about this. Those of you who may have seen a similar presentation I've given in the past, a lot of the stuff I'll talk about today is similar to what I've talked about previously, but I really today am going to stress on an additional point that I think has become more interesting to me over the past few years, and I think is gonna hopefully not confuse things more than it has been in the past, but we'll get to that through the talk. I just wanted to mention that there will be two medications that I'll talk about today, medications that we use to treat reflux here quite frequently that are actually not reflux medications. So these are off-label uses of those medications. So today, really, what I want you guys to learn is really how reflux can affect NTM, pulmonary disease. We'll go through the options that we have for reflux testing, because there are a few, and if you have had reflux testing other places, we'll sort of go over these tests, the pluses and the minuses of both, and what you may be able to ask your local physicians about. Then we will talk about how reflux management may be very different when we are trying to treat the lung manifestations of reflux rather than your traditional heartburn or indigestion symptoms. So we'll talk about really geographically why we think about the GI tract and the lungs being related. And so first, my mom's a realtor, so it's location, location, location here. So what I always think about is the mouth being one tube as it gets down to the throat, but when it gets down to the neck right here, there's a branch in the throat. One branch is the esophagus, which carries everything you swallow down into your lungs. The other branch breaks off, goes through the vocal cords, and down into your lungs, the trachea. Sorry, did I just say lungs before? Down into your stomach, yeah. So I'm gonna bring up a few terms that we're gonna talk about here, okay? And this is gonna be really important. So you'll hear GERD or gastroesophageal reflux disease thrown around quite a bit. So what that refers to is the symptoms that you get from contents from your stomach coming up into the esophagus or higher. You may also see this term called LPR or laryngeopharyngeal reflux, which basically means reflux that's gotten above the esophagus into the throat, where it can affect the vocal cords and other structures in the throat. You'll also hear the term aspiration, which basically means when anything that is not air has gotten past the vocal cords and down into the lungs. And this is sort of the new term that I'm going to throw out there. This term, if you mention it to any other doctor outside of me, probably nobody will have any clue what you're talking about. This is a new term that was developed as part of work that I've done with the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. We put together a workshop to look into the overlap of reflux and lung disease. When you aspirate, it either has to come from the top and go down the wrong way into your lungs when you are swallowing, or it goes down the esophagus and then it can come back up from below and thereby sneak over into the lungs. So what this term, which we've abbreviated GRASP or GI related aspiration, refers to aspiration that's coming from below. So this is to differentiate those folks who may be maybe aspirating as they're swallowing. So this is really what a GI doctor would focus on, or the question we are often asked to answer when we are referred a patient. Does this patient with NTM or bronchiectasis have GRASP? That's really what they're asking, but most of the time they say, is this a reflux problem? And we'll get through the talk why that may not necessarily be the right question. So how common is reflux? So about 60% of adults experience reflux symptoms over a year. About 30 to 40% had reflux symptoms within the past month. And about a quarter or so have weekly reflux symptoms. There's even 10% of folks who have reflux symptoms more than twice a week. So this is a very, very common issue, and certainly is something that's worth thinking about in bronchiectasis and NTM. So when we think about manifestations of reflux, these things down here are the typical things that people think about. So that's chest pain, indigestion, inflammation of the esophagus, maybe even esophagus cancer. There are a lot of other things that have been brought up as potential that reflux can contribute to, such as dental problems and cavities, sinus infections, and even lung symptoms like coughing, asthma. There are a bunch of different lung conditions that have been shown to be potentially affected by reflux. And I think one of the things I think it's important to remember, because this comes up a lot in clinic, people ask, that there can be lung issues that are directly caused by reflux, such as down here, aspiration pneumonia, or even sort of inflammatory changes in the lungs that are directly caused by reflux. But there are a lot of other lung conditions that we see, including bronchiectasis, asthma, COPD, cystic fibrosis, that those diseases aren't necessarily caused by reflux, but they're exacerbated, and the reflux may be a contributing factor to those diseases. So it's important. So everybody always wants to know what caused this. The role of reflux or aspiration is often difficult to tease out whether it's a causative effect or whether it's just contributing to the underlying cause. And that kind of adds to what Dr. Goldstein had sort of talked about previously. So what do we know about reflux with regard to NTM? As Dr. Kastenbauer mentioned, we know that NTM are in our environment. So we come in contact with those NTM on a regular basis. And so this is kind of a pictorial version of what Dr. Kastenbauer just mentioned, where one hypothesis is that we ingest NTM in our water supply. It hangs out in our stomach, and in certain individuals who have reflux, sometimes that reflux only goes up as far as the end of the esophagus or the middle of the esophagus, and it never makes it over into the lungs. That's probably not an issue for most of us. But in those patients who have reflux that breaches the upper esophagus, gets into the throat area, and potentially sneaks over into the lungs, in the proper environment, or in the proper host setting, that can lead to infection. I'm going to present just a couple sort of studies about this. I don't want to get into the weeds with the data on this, but these are studies that have looked at patients who have MAC infection and those who don't have MAC infection. And they basically looked at these two populations of patients and they said, well, who has reflux, or which group had more reflux? What this showed is that the patients with MAC tended to have more reflux. 43% of the patients had GERD, whereas patients who did not have MAC, only about a quarter of those patients had reflux. So it's suggestive that there may be some relationship. And again, you've heard a lot about the chicken and the egg phenomenon here. This study looked at, when we talk about severity or involvement of the lungs, this particularly looked at how many lobes of the lungs are involved on a CT scan. And what it showed was that those patients who had reflux tended to have more lung lobes involved by their bronchiectasis and NTM than did those without reflux. Again, is it a chicken or is it the egg? There's also the U.S. Bronchiectasis Registry data of nearly 2,000 patients. And of these patients, about almost two-thirds had a history of NTM. And out of those, out of the patients in this registry who had reflux, about 50% were NTM. Of the NTM patients, about half of them had abnormal reflux, and if they did not have NTM, they had less chance of having reflux. So again, everything is kind of suggestive that there is a correlation between reflux and NTM or bronchiectasis, but these data are very poor. They're not necessarily prospective studies, randomized studies, very controlled studies. So it's really difficult to make this leap about the connection. So getting back to what I talked about earlier, reflux, again, that may just be going up into the esophagus and never getting into the lungs. That may be irrelevant to this whole conversation. So what we're really worried about is GRASP, is this GI-related aspiration, maybe not reflux, but reflux that's getting into the lungs. So how do we detect that? How do we measure that? We can't. So this is the huge million-dollar question. Because of this, what we do is we measure what we can measure. So we do reflux testing. We do testing to see, is the esophagus moving and clearing itself out well? We do sputum cultures. We do bronchoscopies and lung testing. We do pictures of the lungs. And basically what all these tests are surrogate tests for aspiration. We're not seeing the actual stuff get over into the lungs, but we're saying based on these test results, how likely or unlikely is it that a patient may be aspirating? So this testing really, sorry, it's blocked off there, but what that says is the current testing may tell us how at risk you are of aspiration, but it doesn't necessarily tell us that you're definitely aspirating. So this is sort of the crux of the conversation that has changed from the talks I've given previously, because as I've done work with the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation and really thought about this, talked about this with other experts in both GI and pulmonary, what I've realized is we're probably thinking about this the wrong way. What we probably need to do is we need to have a test that tells us definitively who is aspirating. And whether that's a sputum sample or a bronchoscopy sample or a biopsy, we need an agreed upon diagnostic criteria to say this person is aspirating or this person isn't. And once we know who is aspirating, who has GRASP, then we may be able to do some of these other tests to figure out why and what can we do about it. But so I think we're kind of thinking about this backwards. We're doing the reflux test and then trying to predict based on that test who might be aspirating, rather than I think eventually we need to go the other direction. That test doesn't exist. We're working on that. There are other researchers around the country and world who have potential assays coming down the pipe that may answer this question. So what do we have as far as reflux testing is concerned? This one's everybody's favorite test. It's called the pH impedance study. It involves us sticking this spaghetti-like tube in your nose while you're awake. It goes down the back of your throat, dangles in your esophagus just above the stomach, hangs out of your nose, taped onto your face, hooked up to a recording box, and it stays in there overnight. You go home with it for 22 hours, 24 hours some places. While it's in there, you eat, you drink, you sleep, you go on a walk, you go about your normal day. And there are sensors all along this tube that are measuring how often you are having reflux, with or without you ever feeling it. You may feel it, you may not feel it, but this will tell us how much reflux do you have. And the nice thing about this test is that there are sensors all along this tube. So it not only tells us how much reflux is coming up into the end of your esophagus, but it also tells us how frequently that reflux is reaching the top of the esophagus. And again, that's probably the important part when we're talking about GRASP. Now, the downside to this testing is all the normal and abnormal values, how we read and interpret this test, are all based on what's normal or abnormal for the esophagus. And this is, again, another huge problem with what we have with our testing. So you can have up to 40 reflux events a day and be considered normal. That's true for the esophagus. Now, if 10 of those are getting into your lungs every day, that's probably not normal. And so a lot of patients come to see me and they've gotten these tests done elsewhere. And they say, I had the reflux test. My local doctor didn't think I had a reflux problem. And I say, show me the test. And when we see that there's a lot of reflux coming up high, I don't really care how many total reflux events you have, but that's suggestive that there may be a contribution there. So interpreting the test results in the context of the lungs is very important. And that's something that I have not seen happen very many other, if not anywhere in the across the country, right? The lung, the GI doctors think about reflux from a GI perspective, and oftentimes we'll miss this potential overlap with the lungs. There's a second type of reflux testing that we do called the Bravo pH study. This is a wireless capsule that we place at the end of the esophagus during an endoscopy. While you're asleep under anesthesia, we go down there, we clip this little plastic piece onto the inside of your esophagus. When you wake up, you have no tube hanging out of your nose. You have this little wireless box that you wear around. Most places now are doing this for 96 hours or 4 days. We used to do it for 48 hours, so you may still see that 2 to 4 day measurement. And there are certainly pluses and minuses to that type of testing, which we'll talk about right now. So the Bravo is nice in that it measures for a longer period of time. So when we're talking about reflux, which may not be the same every single day, measuring for a longer period of time may give us a better chance of picking up something abnormal. So the Bravo is a little bit better than the 1 day pH impedance test. Where we get into problems with the Bravo is, as I said, the Bravo is clipped on the bottom part of your esophagus down by your stomach. So it's not telling us anything about how much reflux you have coming up next to your lung. So it may not be, it's a great reflux test, but it may not be a great grasp test, okay? The discomfort, certainly this, the Bravo is done while you're under anesthesia. So it's pretty minimal discomfort. Some people kind of feel that clip in there for a couple of days after, but in general, it's pretty well tolerated. It's much, people like it a lot more than walking around with a tube in their nose. Both of them are able to detect acid reflux, which is the most common type of reflux and the one everybody's heard of. But only the pH impedance study is able to detect non-acid reflux. So there's another type of reflux that most people have not heard of called non-acid reflux. What I mean by that is we all have other stuff in our stomach besides acid that can also come back up. We have other digestive juices that are not acidic. We can have bile in our stomach, which is not acidic. And we eat and drink things like water and milk and things like that. All of that non-acid stuff can come up just as easily as acid can. And no matter what it is that's coming up, if it's getting over into the lungs, it may be bringing with it NTM and other things to cause problems. So if it's not air and it's getting into the lungs, it's a problem. So we need to think about both acid and non-acid reflux. And for that reason, I think when we're evaluating reflux from an NTM or a bronchiectasis standpoint, I think a pH impedance study is much more important than a Bravo study. It gives us much more information. So how do we treat reflux? What controls reflux is a muscle that you have at the bottom of your esophagus called the lower esophageal sphincter. The tighter that muscle is, the less stuff comes back up, the looser it is, or the more it relaxes during the day, the more stuff comes back up. So until you can do something to make that muscle tighter longer, you're never going to impact this whole grasp question. So how do we impact that muscle? Well, there are three ways. There are lifestyle modifications, including diet. There are medications, and there are anti-reflux surgeries or procedures. So this chart is taken from the American Journal of Gastroenterology. So this is the sort of GI recommend society recommendations on what's been shown to be helpful or not helpful in treating reflux. So remember, this is important to remember. This is data that is known about reflux. This is not data that is known about aspiration or grasp. And so whether or not any of these things is applicable to aspiration, who knows? Because a lot of people ask me in clinic, well, I was told these 500 things I need to do to stop reflux or to prevent reflux. Which one should I concentrate on? Are they all necessary? Or the answer is nobody has any idea. Okay. But what we do know is, at least from these studies, they've shown that these three things that I've put a square around are all things that have either improved reflux symptoms or improved formal reflux testing. Okay. So we have objective data to show that reflux, maybe not aspiration, but at least reflux improves. So that's weight loss. Again, that's strongly recommended for patients with a BMI over 25. Head of the bed elevated. We generally recommend raising the head of your bed 4 to 6 inches. And avoidance of late night meals. Again, usually 2 to 3 hours within eating. We don't want you going to lay down. Again, these things have been shown to improve reflux. Whether or not they improve aspiration, we have no idea. There are other things down on the bottom of this list that we often talk about, both alcohol and nicotine, as well as chocolate, spicy foods, carbonated beverages. There are some studies that have shown that this doesn't really do anything for symptoms. It does not necessarily affect the pH, the acid in the esophagus, but the studies didn't look at non-acid reflux. So we have no idea whether or not that's helpful. So I tell people, play around with it. Yeah, try stopping alcohol or backing off on the number of glasses of wine you drink on a weekly basis. Let's see if it makes a difference in some of your symptoms. Same thing with these. No studies perform. We don't know anything about it. We don't know anything about any of this. So the recommendations for the use of standard reflux medications, which are called PPIs or proton pump inhibitors, what this says, the GI Society basically says, if you have a lung symptom, only use these medications if you also have esophagus symptoms of reflux. If you have heartburn and indigestion, well, sure, an acid reducer may be really helpful. But it's probably not necessary by itself to treat a lung problem from reflux. And they even go so far as to say, in the absence of an esophagus reflux issue, they recommend against the use of these acid reducers. So why aren't acid reducers the right choice in treating reflux? Well, here's a study that looked at the red column are people who were not on any reflux medication. The orange column are people who were on reflux medicine. And we measured the amount of reflux that was in the top, the proximal esophagus up by the throat, the middle esophagus, and the distal esophagus down by the stomach. And basically what you can see clearly here is that whether or not you are on an acid reducer, you have the same amount of reflux. Acid reducers don't stop reflux from happening. So what do they do? Well, this is another study that looked at total number of reflux events. So again, this first box here is no treatment. They saw that those patients had a mixture of acid reflux and non-acid reflux. And then they put them on omeprazole, which is an acid reducer, twice a day for a week. And they stuck this tube back down their nose and they did reflux testing. And what they showed is that they had the exact same number of reflux events, if not more. But what happened is all of those acid events basically went away. We got rid of the acid with the medicine. It worked. But what happened is all those acid events became non-acid events. Stuff's still coming back up. Now it's just less acidic. And that's really, really important. This is very striking. And so what this shows is that PPIs reduce acid. They don't reduce reflux. So that's why here we sort of think about and treat reflux very, very differently than how you may have been treated elsewhere. Dr. Honda, who's here, did this study in her lab here at National Jewish. This is a study that really gets at, well, are we actually potentially putting you more at risk of NTM by putting you on acid reducers. Now we're getting rid of your indigestion, your heartburn. You don't think you have a reflux problem anymore, but it may still be coming up. So what she did was she actually grew Mycobacterium abscessus in different acidic conditions. And what she saw in the white column is the least acidic, and the orange column is the most acidic. And what you can see is that in the acidic conditions, early on, 1 hour after incubation, inoculation, you saw some mycobacteria in there. But then as you followed that, in these, you don't see any mycobacterium in the highly acidic conditions. But what you do see is in those more basic or less acidic conditions, you actually see a growth of mycobacteria. So when we put people on PPIs and acid reducers, are we actually making the environment in the stomach more prone to grow mycobacteria? Now, if you're having reflux, now that reflux is bringing more mycobacteria with it. And we may be putting you more at risk of lung infection, or at least make it harder to eradicate that mycobacterial infection. So are there medicines that actually reduce reflux? The first one I'll talk about is baclofen. So this is a medicine that's a muscle relaxer used by neurologists for people who have muscle spasms in their back and in their neck. The sphincter muscle is a different type of muscle than what you have in your back. And interestingly, the baclofen works the opposite on the sphincter muscle. So it actually tightens the sphincter muscle, and it prevents that sphincter muscle from relaxing as much after we eat, as pressure builds up in our stomach. And this is one small study that was done in 2003, so a long 20 years ago, which showed both in healthy volunteers and in people who have reflux, the black line is placebo, the other line is baclofen. You can see that the total number of reflux events drops with baclofen, and that includes both the acid events as well as the non-acid reflux events. So this is a way to actually reduce the total number of reflux events rather than just changing the acidity of it, which may decrease your risk of aspiration or GRASP. Doesn't bring it to zero. Doesn't get rid of reflux, but it reduces your risk. Bethanacol is another medication. This is a urology medicine to help the bladder empty out better. It's used for a condition called urinary retention, makes the bladder squeeze and empty out more fully. Well, what we also have seen is that it improves the squeeze of the esophagus, where it can make that muscle at the end called the LES, or lower esophageal sphincter, increase in pressure, which can help reduce reflux from coming back up. There are no studies that have been done in reflux on Bethanacol. So all of what I'm telling you is kind of anecdotal evidence and what we have seen with use in the clinic and doing studies on and off of these medications. We can show that it in some patients, it does reduce the number of reflux episodes, similar to how baclofen works. Then there are anti-reflux surgeries. So if diet doesn't work, if lifestyle modifications don't work, and we try these medications, there's something about the end of the esophagus that's just too darn loose, and reflux is continuing to come up no matter what we do. Well, what can we do about it? Well, structurally, we can go down, surgeon can go in laparoscopically often, take the top part of the stomach, wrap it around the end of the esophagus, and basically make a belt around the end of your esophagus. It's called a Nissen fundoplication. It's a standard anti-reflux procedure. It's been around for decades. And basically, there's pretty good data to show that it can significantly reduce the number of reflux events you have. Now, there are certainly downsides to it. When you tighten up the end of the esophagus, sometimes you have swallowing issues because that area is tight now. So now we prevented reflux from coming back up, but we've also prevented other stuff from coming back up, like burping, vomiting is almost impossible or very difficult to do after that surgery. So there are reasons why it's a last resort for us. When the esophagus is not moving properly, the last thing you want to do is make that end of the esophagus super tight. Yeah, we stopped your reflux, but now your esophagus isn't squeezing enough to get the stuff through that tight area. So now we've traded your reflux for stuff backing up in your esophagus. So we always do movement testing of the esophagus before we think about reflux surgery. And in patients who do not have adequate movement in their esophagus, They may not want a full tight wrap, and they do what's called a partial fundoplication, where they kind of tighten it up a little bit, but not too much. And then there's a newer procedure that's been around for a little more than a decade now called the Lynx procedure. What it is it's basically a bracelet of magnetic beads that are laparoscopically placed around the end of the esophagus. The difference between this and this is that this is kind of a static tightness. It's tight and it doesn't loosen up at all. What happens with these magnetic beads is as you swallow, as pressure builds up in your esophagus, enough pressure can be generated to separate the magnetic beads. So it can open, allow food to go through, or if you need to vomit, you can vomit with this in, and then it gets tight again after the food goes through. So it kind of works similar to how that normal sphincter muscle in your body is supposed to work. So the take-home points from this talk are that the GI tract and the lungs are really close together, and we should always be thinking about a potential overlap in these two systems. Not necessarily reflux, but GRASP, GI-related aspiration, likely plays a role in NTM infection, but we cannot definitively diagnose GRASP. So what we're left with is choosing the proper test, proper reflux test, one that evaluates how high the reflux is going and can evaluate both types of reflux to see how at risk or not at risk a patient may be for GRASP. And then once you do the proper test, you need to interpret it properly. You need to interpret it in the context of the lungs. And lastly, not all reflux is acid, and acid reducers actually don't reduce reflux. So treating reflux with regard to NTM infection and bronchiectasis, you really want to do something that decreases the number of reflux events you have. And to do that, there are lifestyle modifications. There are certain medications, which again are not your typical reflux medicines. And there's also surgery. And that's all I have. Sure.
How about the use of the Algidate wrap, reflux coordinator, Gaviscon product? Have you tried it with patients who use it consistently, and have you measured with one of these tests?
Yeah, so the question was about, we talked about medications other than traditional PPIs that may reduce reflux. The question was, is a preparation like alginate useful in reducing reflux? So this is a product that basically creates a so-called raft or a barrier on the top of the fluid pocket that you have in your stomach in an attempt to prevent reflux from coming back up. There's, again, with as far as aspiration is concerned, there are no studies I am aware of that have ever looked at that. We use that anecdotally, and in the future that probably should be added to the talk as a potential thing to consider along with baclofen and bethanacol. Those alginate products do work in a way that in some studies have shown an actual decrease in the number of reflux events. Again, so anecdotally, yes, we use them. No, there are no studies that have looked at before and after number of reflux events. I always have, they're not my first go-to just because they don't have any effect on the lower esophageal sphincter. And really that's what we're trying to affect. As long as that muscle is still opening and closing, you're still at risk of stuff coming back up. And so I focus more, at least initially, on medications or lifestyle modifications that can affect the lower esophageal sphincter. But alginate probably is a useful thing to consider as part of the toolbox that we have for this.
How does a small hernia affect acid reflux?
So the question was, how does a small hernia, a hiatal hernia, I'm assuming you're talking about, affect reflux? So the esophagus, as it goes down the chest, has to pass through a muscle called the diaphragm that sits underneath your lungs. That's the muscle that moves up and down, and that's why you breathe. The diaphragm separates the chest cavity from the abdominal cavity, and normally the stomach sits below the diaphragm. The opening in the diaphragm where the esophagus passes through is called the hiatus of the diaphragm. So a hiatal hernia is when some of the stomach slides up through the diaphragm and you wind up with a little bit of your stomach in your chest where it doesn't belong. When that happens, the sphincter muscle, which is normally right where the esophagus passes through the diaphragm, so it's actually working together with the diaphragm to keep that area tight. When you have a hernia, now that sphincter muscle is up above the diaphragm. So it's not working together with the diaphragm. And as a result, the end of the esophagus is usually looser than it should be. So with a hiatal hernia, it loosens up the end of the esophagus and it makes you more prone to having reflux. Doesn't mean you're definitely going to have reflux. It doesn't mean you're going to aspirate. It just means you're more at reflux than somebody else who doesn't have a hiatal hernia. So whether or not you have a hiatal hernia, in my mind, the most important part is, do you have reflux? Do you have a lot of reflux? And is it coming all the way back up your esophagus? And if you have a hiatal hernia, but you don't have any significant reflux, then who cares? If you do have a hiatal hernia and we can demonstrate that you have a lot of reflux, we still will first try to treat that reflux with medications and diet and all that. But patients with a hiatal hernia may be less responsive to those treatments because that area is structurally looser to begin with, and the medications may not work as well. And patients with hiatal hernia may be more likely to need some sort of structural correction or surgery in the future. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Has there been any changes in esophageal motility as you age? And I had the standard tests 12-15 years ago.
So the question was, are there changes in esophageal motility or movement as you age? So yes, all the muscles in our body don't work as well as we age. And that includes the esophagus. Although it is rare for that to be clinically significant, or you to go from your esophagus moving normally when you're younger to not moving at all when you're older, just as a result of aging. There are other conditions that you develop over the course of your life that may affect the motility, but age alone is unlikely to be the main underlying cause of movement problems of the esophagus. But it is something that we look at, because if your esophagus is not moving properly or clearing itself out, and food and drink is spending longer in the esophagus than it should, it may be refluxing up from your esophagus and getting into your lungs, not refluxing up from your stomach. And that's a whole nother ball of wax that is a different type of reflux that we would have to treat differently. And if you are having reflux, and you're from the stomach and your esophagus is not pushing properly, that reflux may come up higher in the esophagus and may be more likely to overlap into your lungs.
So would you do an impedance test? Is that like
so the
way you test
that? Yeah, so the impedance study is a reflux test, just looks at reflux, but it's all here. In most places now, the standard of care is to always do the pH impedance test with a test called an esophageal manometry study, which is a 20-minute long tube down your nose test while you're awake, where you swallow a bunch of times. And there are pressure sensors on that tube that precisely measure how the esophagus is moving and clearing. So they're generally done together. So we get both information about reflux, but we also get information about esophagus function and movement. Sure. So the question was to just talk a little bit more about the off-label use of baclofen and bethanacol and what our sort of success rate has been. The first thing I always tell people is baclofen. So both of those medications, there are no known long-term downsides or effects of taking those medications. With baclofen, because it's a muscle relaxer, the typical side effects include drowsiness, lightheadedness, wooziness, fatigue. Because most of the relaxation of that sphincter muscle happens after we eat, when we use both medications, we generally give, so baclofen is usually three times a day, 30 to 60 minutes before breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Bethanacol is breakfast, lunch, dinner, bedtime, four times a day. Baclofen, again, muscle relaxer side effects are the big things that we see with that. Bethanacol does not cross into the brain, so it shouldn't have those same fatigue or drowsiness effects. It may make you feel like you have to pee more because it's a bladder medicine. That's kind of what it does, although that's rare to be a significant side effect. It can also make the airway a little bit more squeezy. So it can worsen asthma. If you have bad asthma or wheezing, chest tightness, you can see worsening in those symptoms. So typically in patients that are coming in with a lot of lung symptoms, we generally prefer baclofen. But I use them interchangeably. I think they both work equally as well. The efficacy, again, this is complete anecdote. You know, this is not based on any studies at all, but 10 to 25% of the time they work really well in patients, and 50%, you know, the other 50 or 75% of the time they don't necessarily fix the problem. But in that subset, that 75% that didn't fix the problem, maybe half of those will see an improvement in their symptoms. And again, it depends on what you look at. It depends if you look at testing that shows the effects on the actual number of reflux events, where usually it does in most people decrease reflux. Whether or not that correlates with any decrease in symptoms, that's a harder thing to figure out. Sure.
Would there be any study or thought to explore the relationship with autoimmune disease? If, for instance, for patients with neuropathy, there's a chance the immune system may be attacked. And would that be relationship with how it manifests the disability of esophagus?
So the question was about dysmotility or abnormal motility in the esophagus and the relationship potentially with autoimmune diseases. There's clear evidence that several autoimmune diseases like lupus or connective tissue diseases like scleroderma, Sjogren syndrome being an autoimmune disease, can certainly affect motility of the entire GI tract, not just the esophagus, but the stomach and the intestines. So there's clear data to show that that's the case. There is also data to show that with what's called autonomic dysfunction, or in this sort of interaction between the nerves and many different organ systems, that that can affect motility of the GI tract. The big question, so a lot of times we can pick up these abnormal movements on testing. The big question is, what do you do about it and can you fix it? So we often say treat the underlying cause. You know, if you have lupus, we treat lupus. We see if it helps with the movement, but there's no specific medication or treatment necessarily that has clearly been shown to basically make your esophagus start moving properly again. So bethanacol, again, I mentioned there's some basic, you know, sort of laboratory evidence to show it may improve the contractility of the esophagus, but it's not going to make it go back to what it was doing when you were 10 years old. So we don't have a lot of good treatments when we pick up abnormal esophagus movement.